have your Bibles, if you'd be so kind to turn to the Gospel according to St. Luke chapter 22, beginning with verse 31. The Gospel according to Dr. Luke, chapter 22, beginning at verse 31, and we're going to read down through verse 34. St. Luke, chapter 22, verse 31 through 34. While you're turning, certainly we give all praises and adoration to our Heavenly Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit that dwells within us. To all of our ministers, to all of our deacons, to all of you that make up this worship celebration service. Amen. I would assume that everybody's there.
Amen.
Yeah, good assumption. All right. Before we go any further, did anybody just come to hear a word from God today?
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Amen. I mean, do you really want a word?
All right.
And I'll read it from my American Standard King James Version. It says, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded permission to sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail. And you, when once you have turned again, strengthen your brother.
Oh yes.
But he said unto him, Lord, with you I'm ready to go, both to prison and to death. And he said, I say to you, Peter, the rooster will not crow until you have denied me three times that you know me. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
The preacher's going to talk about how to fail without becoming a failure. How to fail without becoming a failure. Amen. Bow your heads with me, please. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you today. We thank you for your word. Thank you for the time that we spent with you as we was seeking and preparing this message. We pray now that you would be with us as we deliver it. We pray that if there's anyone in this place today who spiritual death, we pray now that you would open their ears that they may hear what your Spirit is saying to the church. Forgive us all of our sins and all of our shortcomings. You said in your word, the man said he has no sin. That man is a liar and truth is not in him. But if we're willing to confess our faults, you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In Jesus' name we pray. A preaching grace. Amen. How to fail without becoming a failure. How to fail without becoming a failure. It is said that Ernest Hemingway, the famous and best-selling writer who won the Nobel Prize for Literature, was well known for his adventurous spirit and distinctive writing style. He ended his career as an alcoholic and committed suicide at the age Adolf Merkel, a German billionaire, one of the top 100 richest people in the world, committed suicide after he ran into deep financial trouble. He lost hundreds of millions of dollars with his company, and the economic crisis. This morning, I want to talk to you about how to fail without becoming a failure. And someone may be asking the question by now, what's the difference? The difference is everybody fails. There's not a person in this room have not experienced failure.
That's right.
People fail in school. People fail at businesses. People fail in their marriages. People fail in parenting. People fail in their careers. And we as believers, we fail the Lord. Everybody fails.
That's right.
The question is now how bad, the question is not how bad the failure is, the question is how good the response to the failure is. A person is not finished when he fails. A person is finished when he gives up. As hard as it is to admit that you and I, every one of us have failed, but just because you fail doesn't mean that you are a failure. There's a big difference. A good example is the difference between two of Jesus' disciples, Simon Peter in this text, and Judas Iscariot. Both men failed Christ. Peter by denying his Lord Jesus, Judas by betraying his Lord, but Judas ended up a failure. Drowning so deep in regret and despair, he committed suicide. Peter, on the other hand, seemed to get past his failures and become one of the most important leaders in the early church. What made the difference between failing and being a failure? I think you can get some clues from the conversation between Jesus and Simon Peter recorded in this text we've read, verses 31 through 34. The words of Jesus are encouraging to Peter, an encouragement for everybody who fails, about how to handle failure, to get past your failing, and to become the person that God created you to be. Jesus' words give us three truths to encourage us when we fail. Now here for those that hear this text, takes place in the upper room. Jesus had just finished with his disciples celebrating the Passover. Jesus had instituted the Lord's Supper, as we are going to take up this morning. And only Dr. Luke shares this story with us. The other Gospels do not share what Luke shares with us this morning. And there Jesus focuses in on his disciples. And notice here in verse 31 that we read, help me here, Holy Spirit. He says in verse 1, Simon. It's amazing that he called him Simon because it was Simon was his name, but Jesus gave him another name, which was Peter. And so here he called him by his name, and he says, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded permission to seek you. Like we. There's so much here. I want to pull out this passage. There's three things I want you to get, and then I'm going to share three more things with you. The first thing that Jesus shares with Peter is spiritual insight. Amen. Spiritual insight. The second thing that he shares that I'm going to intercede for you. And then the other thing that we see in this text is that Peter seems to ignore the things that Jesus shared. But I want to begin here, and I want to drop this down on you, that Satan wants to use your failure to drag you down.
You're right, Pastor.
That's insight. I wish y'all would help me here. That's insight. And this is what God is saying to us today and to those of you, that Satan wants to use your failure to drag you down. And so Jesus says here, I want to just take a minute to give you spiritual insight into the spiritual world. Jesus knew that the attack was about to be launched against the disciples. And this passage shows how he prepared his disciples. It is a strong warning that Satan does not attack the believer. Satan's desire is to sift the believer. That is to separate him from God. If Satan can get you separated from your power source, y'all hear what I'm saying? He can drag you down. Amen. Notice here, he gives them insight. He says, I want you to know the devil has already demanded permission to sift you. In other words, it's just like Job. The Bible tells us that Job, was a righteous man, and one day when the sons of God came to get their assignments, the Bible says that Satan came also. And so Jesus met Satan and he says, what's up? He said, oh, I've just been to and fro walking throughout the earth looking whom I might devour. And so here this morning is that before Jesus goes on the cross, he gives us spiritual insight, and he's talking to Peter, but he's really talking to all 11 of the apostles.
That's right.
He says, Satan has demanded permission. Now, let me help you to understand insight. I thought about this as I was preparing this text yesterday when that brother got burned out there, and he was walking all over the place, and he was just barely hanging in there to the paramedics out there. It didn't just happen yesterday when Sister Thomas passed by, but you know what it happened? Around the throne. I wish I could help you to understand that nothing happens in this universe unless it's God, okay. Satan just can't go around being destructive and hurting us and create chaos unless he get permission. Notice what Jesus said in his insight. He says, Satan has, amen, he has, he has, He has demanded permission. Now, I don't mean to say all this, but I want you to get this. In other words, he says to Jesus, he says, you let me have them 11 disciples. I'll show you ain't nothing to them.
Lord, yeah.
Isn't that what he told the Lord about Job?
Yeah.
He says, you got to have your protection around him. Who wouldn't praise you?
He said,
let me take all this stuff. Let me take his material wealth. I'll make an impression to him.
Lord,
he says, just let me have these notes. I don't even been with you 3.5 years, but if you just let me tell him for a little bit, I'll show you. Ain't nothing to him. And I tell you that he's going back and forth.
Yes, he is.
He's saying to them old deacon, just let me have
him.
To the preacher. Just let me have him.
Yeah.
To the old people.
Yeah.
Just let me have him for a little while.
Yeah.
That's spiritual insight.
Yes,
Lord, help God.
The word desire means to beg for something. In other words, Satan wanted these disciples, he wanted Peter so bad, he was begging.
Mm-hmm.
Just let me have it. In other words, notice here, I like this, that Jesus pictures Satan as begging permission of God to trip the disciples.
Mm.
Amen. The word silly, help me here, Holy Spirit, means to shake, to shift, in a sifter in order to separate good grain from chaff. In other words, Satan said, if you make me have what I get to shake in his world, ain't gonna be nothing. Lord have mercy, sometimes I think about this text, I think about my life and all the things that he's done to shake me. I think about the material wealth that I've lost and other things that have happened, but I'm still standing. And when I look at this text, it's not because of my strength. Satan wants to use your failure to drag you down. Let me move. Notice here that. Now Jesus says, but
Mama,
I have prayed.
Thank you.
For you.
Thank you.
Amen. But I pray. He asked for permission. I've given him permission. But I pray.
Yes,
sir. Oh, we ought to just thank God that we have him. And he's never seen it. For them deacons over there.
Yeah.
For these ministers, for me, for all of you. Jesus has never seen. In other words, Jesus revealed this spiritual insight that we as believers, we have an advocate.
Thank you,
Jesus.
An advocate is a term like we have an attorney. We have a representative in heaven. When the accuser comes, I don't know whether y'all know this, although Satan been kicked out of heaven, he can't spend the night, but he does have access.
Uh-huh.
We have somebody up there.
Thank you.
Who's sitting on the right hand of the Father.
Thank you.
In other words, if you just let me have him, I test them, I try them, I prove that they're not genuine. But notice the next thing here in verse 32. As we just said, Satan wants to use failure to drag you down. My second point. is that Jesus can use failure to lift you up.
Oh, yes. That's right.
Amen. Jesus can use failure to lift you up.
That's right.
Amen. Peter and others, disciples, they were stoned. But Jesus prayed that they would not remain down. Have you ever been down?
Oh, yes.
I'm talking to somebody here that, you know, been living for the Lord, and the next thing you know, all hell broke loose.
Oh, yes.
And everything that you had planned went down the drain. Jesus can use failure to lift you up. Yes, he can. I'm going to move because I'm running out of time. He can use failure to lift you up. I'm encouraged that Peter's failure doesn't cause Jesus to write him off.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you.
You know, this is a very trying time for our nation. And I thought about it, people went back on me when I was in high school, I wouldn't be able to stand behind this desk. Don't y'all hold nothing at me. I'm not trying to preach politics.
Yeah. We hear you, Pastor.
But isn't it good to know that Peter's failure doesn't cause Jesus to write him off? You will fail me too, but I'm not going to give up on you.
My Lord.
In fact, I pray that your faith shall not fail, and when you have returned to me.
Wow.
Lord, have mercy. Peter, I know you're going to fail by denying me, but I'm asking my Father to strengthen you so that your faith in me will not end up a total run. Just because you messed up don't mean that it's over. If you're in Christ.
That's right.
Amen. My third point, I'm going to my second point. Jesus can use failure to lift us up. Because Peter was humble. He was humble. The last thing he said was, not me.
That's all right.
Let me move on. My third one. Jesus calls us to lift up others who fail.
That's right.
This is what he said. He says, but he says here, I pray to you, and once you have turned again, in other words, once you failed, once you messed up, and you turn back to me for strength, strengthen your brother. Strengthen your brother. What is he saying? I'm going to try to make this plain today. One of the most amazing things about failure is that Jesus called people who failed to help others who failed.
Amen.
I remember when the Lord called me and preached, he said, I want you to counsel for me. Have the man right. I said, woo, bitch. All the promises, tongues that I had when we first got married. And that's what Jesus said to Peter. Once you have failed, once you turn, strengthen others.
Yeah. Oh, yes. That's it.
I can just come out right here. Yeah. Sometimes you can't help nobody if you haven't gone through that. When you never had a problem, you never lost $400,000 or $500,000, you don't know what it's like to lose. You never been through a divorce? You don't know what it's like. Jesus calls us to lift up others who fail. Now, and I'm mad, Peter said, Lord, I'm so unworthy. Look at what I've done. The one who grabbed your mouth. And the same night,
yes,
I denied you three times. Peter, you can strength him because you know what it's like to fail.
Yeah.
Amen. You can help somebody else when you mess up. You can help somebody. You can help somebody. You can teach somebody how to fail without becoming a failure. Let me move on. When we look here, and Peter, you know the story, Peter denied it. But before I go there, let me just help you here. Because 34, he says, I say to you, Peter, the rooster will not crow today until you have denied me three times that you know me. In other words, this is still spiritual insight.
Yes, sir.
Because Jesus knows us better than we know ourselves.
That's right.
Some of us don't know what we're going to do.
Lord, help us.
Before the sun goes down. Amen. And can I just tell you this? Certainly Peter was no stranger to failure. And so here, one other thing I want you to get is that Peter seemed to ignore everything that Jesus just revealed to him. Not me. How many times did God send a rhema word to the church?
Talk about it.
And we get up and walk out and say, that must have been to Brother Paul over there. Not me. And so here, he seemed to ignore Jesus' warning, but because, you know, Jesus said before one jot or one tittle of my word failed, heaven and earth passed away. And just because you ignore it, just because you don't believe it, if Jesus said it's going to come to pass.
Oh, yes.
Amen. In other words, I'm preparing you, Peter, how to fail without becoming a failure. In other words, when you fail, and when you have moped, and you have sobbed, and you have had your pity party, I want you to get up and turn back to me. And I will complete the good work in you that I started. Can I get with you? And he says, Peter, when you are converted, in other words, when you have turned back to me, I want you to strengthen, brother.
Come on.
Let me just tell you how Peter strengthened his brother. Peter wrote 1st and 2nd Peter. Peter is writing to the 12 tribes of Israel, and these Christians have accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Many of them have lost their houses, they lost their jobs, they lost everything. And they was in hiding. And so Peter writes to them to encourage them. And many of them had wanted to just give up on Jesus Christ and go back to Judaism because it didn't cost them anything. And so Peter encouraged those Jews by telling them that we are nothing but strangers,
Lord,
in this world.
Right. Right.
We're just passing through.
That's right.
Yes, sir. Amen. See, if you ever been down, if you ever messed up, and you can relate to someone.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Can I get a witness?
Yes,
let me tell you why he failed. Peter failed because his purpose and desires was earthly. See, they thought that Jesus was going to eventually set up his kingdom. He was going to destroy the Romans and he was going to set up the throne. They didn't know that Jesus, the first time he came to die. They didn't understand that. That's why Peter drew his sword. And although Jesus had been telling him going to Jerusalem to die. That's all, man. He just saying that, man. He's getting ready to restore Israel. And see, the reason that he fell is that because he misunderstood God's purpose for his life. There was the difference between purpose and desire. See, Peter's desire was, and Jesus had told him, when the Messiah, when I come to sit upon my throne, you all gonna rule with me. See, some of us will serve God as long as we get blessed. As long as we get our share of material stuff. See, some of us, if you want to tell where a person is, sometimes you take some of that stuff they got. And so Peter, in other words, Peter had a strong commitment. His commitment and desire was to have earthly and material things. But what Jesus wanted him to have was a spiritual commitment with purpose and desire to have spiritually and heavenly things. When Peter went through it, he messed up. Peter got his mind off of earthly things. And guess what? He kept his eye on the star post in glory.
Yes, he did.
Peter realized that we're just strangers. We're just passing through. Don't get me focused on all this stuff. That's why he writes about it in verse 1. He had to get refocused. And let me tell you something, you too, you're going to fail because if you think that the kingdom of God is all about increase, you set yourself up.
That's right.
Amen.
Fulfill.
Yes.
You know, God had to teach me a valuable lesson, and I know y'all love for me talking about my shortcomings. But there was a time I come from the country, I didn't have that much, didn't have nothing, and God began to bless me, and after a while I got caught up in it, and I felt like I was supposed to have this. I'm a believer, walking right with the Lord. Abraham was blessed. But I'm no failure, period.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And Don't let the world cause you to give up on Jesus because you fail. Let me close. I want you to know this. I want you to know this too, that there's a difference. There's a difference in just turning back to God than being restored. You know, God is a restorer. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? See, God, let me get this. I want you to know that Job, you know, when the devil came against Satan, he took everything he had. He took his children, took his wealth, he took everything, took his health. But I thank God today that God just don't leave us hanging. Amen. He don't just leave us. He restores us. Yes. He's a God that restores. See, God, let me just tell somebody, God don't care about how much stuff you have. Don't get the wrong, don't get it twisted. As long as the stuff don't have
me.
And all I was trying to say was I hadn't come to a point in my life when the stuff had me. But guess what? If God allowed you to go through some things and lose some things and all that, then guess what he's going to do? When you turn to him, he's going to restore it. Hallelujah. Praise God. I got to stop here for time, but I'm just not getting winded up. That's what we want to tell you today. How to fail without becoming a failure. I hope and pray you bless.
Amen.
All things in my life, isn't it good to know that Jesus has been praying for you?
Amen.
And he's here to lift you up. So if you're here today and you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is a good day to come down and give these preachers your hand, but give God your heart. Jesus stands here waiting on you. He stands waiting on you to come. Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth that the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Some of you may be walking around and you think you failed and you think that there's no coming back from it, but just as Pastor just said, you may have failed, but you're not a failure. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Or perhaps you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but you realize that you backslidden, you've gone the wrong direction, and maybe you feel that you failed, but today is a good day to come back and give your life back to Christ. Rededicate your life to Christ today. Or maybe God has led you to this place. He may have led you to this place that you might find a church membership here where you can be led and fed the true gospel of Jesus Christ. Or maybe you're just going through some things. You just need some prayer. You just need help. You just need someone to pray with you. That's why these ministers are here this morning, that they will stand with you and pray with you and guide you through whatever you're going through. Today is a great day to give your life to Christ.